Yes, I'm especially happy to visit Bulgaria because, as it has just been recalled, this is a country that has decided to take global development seriously. As a matter of fact, it's a country that moved in a few years from the status of being an aid recipient to the status of being an aid donor. And this quotation by Richard Kapuscinski from his book, The Shadow of the Sun, which says, "We are in a world in which man, crawling on the earth, tries to dig a few grains of wheat out of the mud just to survive another day." Now, the issue or the question I want to address in this lecture is whether globalization is changing or will change
this situation and how.
Today there are 6.5 billion people living on Earth. Among them, if we define a poverty line, and I'll come back to the definition of the poverty line a little later, but if we accept the poverty line, which has been used by international organizations for quite some time now, which is this poverty line of $1.25 to survive every day, dollars being in converted in the purchasing power parity of the countries we are looking at, so that the purchasing power of this dollar is comparable across countries, then we have 1.4 billion people who are poor, who are extremely poor. We know that there is more than 1 billion people who have no access to drinking water, and there are more than 2 billion people without sanitation. And on top of this, 11 million children every year die before age 5 because of health facilities which are inappropriate. And there are more than 100 million children at school age who are not going to school. So the point about global poverty is that you have one quarter of the whole population which lives as people were living at the middle age or at the beginning of the middle age. Now you may say that this is unacceptable, this is outrageous, and you would be, of course, completely right. And as global citizens, I think that we should be really irritated to see that this is still the case today, that we have this kind of poverty. And the last part I would like to mention is that I think this is issue, global poverty is an issue for which we should feel passionate. We should be passionate in order to reduce poverty in the world. But at the time we want to reflect on what are the best tools, what is the best strategy to indeed be able to reduce poverty, then we must, for a moment, put aside our passion and be looking or be thinking in a very cold way to what are the determinants and what can be done. What is the effect of globalization on poverty? And before looking at the effect of globalization on poverty, we need to say something about the way in which the channels through which globalization may at the end affect poverty in a specific country. Now, what we have to keep in mind from that point of view is the fact that monetary poverty depends on the reduction, the speed of reduction depends on economic growth and depends on the change in inequality. If in a country everybody's income is growing exactly at the same rate, then inequality is not changing, but poverty will be going down because you'll have more and more people jumping over the poverty line. Now, if you're in a country where at the same time incomes are growing, but relative incomes are changing, then if the relative income of the poor people is lagging behind the income of the rich people, then of course poverty will not decline as fast as if there was no change in inequality. And possibly, we may be in situations where inequality, where poverty will increase because inequality is becoming really very, very big. On the other hand, if we are in a country where the income of the relative income of rich people is moving down with respect to the income of poor people, then we say that this country is enjoying something we call poor growth, and in that case poverty will fall more quickly than if inequality was not changing. So the point is, if we want to understand the way in which globalization is affecting poverty, we need to study the way in which globalization is affecting growth and the way in which globalization is affecting inequality. What domestic policies can do. Domestic policies, at the end, are the most important. Many people say, we don't know very much about the way in which growth takes place in one country, doesn't take place in another. So this is wrong. Over time, we have learned a lot of things about the determinants of growth. But one thing we have learned, and one thing which is not necessarily applied, especially by international development agencies and bilateral development agencies, is the fact that there is no universal recipe. We cannot say to a country, do this, do that, do this, this is the rule, and then we'll be able to grow very fast. This has been a big mistake made in the past. The fact that there is no universal recipe, and development strategies must be designed at the country level, taking into account the specific context of the country. And from that point of view, we have learned a lot, and we must let governments in those countries use the knowledge that we have accumulated over time in order to design their own strategy, because they are the best people to know what their constraints are. So from that point of view, progress again can be made by government in developing countries and by the international community. Because of the social policies developed by President Lula, following, I must say, his predecessor, Presidente Cardoso, we observe that inequality is going down. This means that poor people, as a matter of fact, are faring much better today in Brazil, in relative terms, than they were in the past, which means that they have benefited, they are benefiting from the acceleration of growth in Brazil in a very effective way. So this shows that redistribution policies are possible. There are many experimentations today in some African countries of the same kind of program, and we know that these programs are working, which means that even though there are possibilities that growth-oriented policies may affect distribution, may be going more in favor of the rich than of the poor, there are instruments in the hands of governments which permit to correct that evolution. Efforts are still needed for sustainable and inclusive global development. We have seen that progress was underway, that the situation, which is absolutely outrageous, to still have poverty today at the level that I have described at the beginning, that this situation is being corrected progressively, but probably not fast enough. So we still need to make some effort in order to make sure that the Millennium Development Goals will not be maybe reached, but will be approached at a reasonable distance in 2015, that growth will be fast, that inequality will not increase in the developing world.